Orioles 84, The Magic Continues, is brought to you by your Baltimore area Toyota dealers, who ask, what will you do with all the money you save?
Good evening and welcome to Orioles 84, The Magic Continues. We come to you from beautiful Miami, a spring home of the Baltimore Orioles. Now, last year when we sat here, we talked about a team that missed making the playoffs and perhaps a world championship by about this much. This year, things were quite a little bit different. The Orioles coming back after a world championship, and tonight we'll examine spring training for the world champion, Baltimore Orioles.
Spring training, a world far removed from the harsh realities of winter far to the north. A world unto itself where time is measured in innings and at-bats, and the pace is deliberate and methodical.
One, two, three, four.
The South Florida sun warms the muscles and the spirit. Spring training seems to put everyone in the best of humor. Spring training is a time for levity. A time when the boys of summer can really behave like little boys.
I'm and the boss.
Oh, you know, you see that?
Yeah.
This new sensation makes you feel great. Just look at me. I lost it. Gonna go again.
A time when even the manager gets to slip into a long forgotten past and take a few cuts with the young guys. When the players' wives get as much attention as the players themselves.
Good. Keep going. Keep smiling. Maybe, yeah. Good. This is very good.
And a time when the players can sneak away from gloves and games to enjoy the midwinter warmth of Florida. What's up?
Hand him up here. That's a good sign, one too.
Yeah, brother.
Spring training is watching a superstar like Eddie Murray ignore a sudden rainstorm to demonstrate what else he can do with a bat. And it's watching Eddie do what he does best with a bat. Spring training is indeed a special time for all teams, but it's even a sweeter time for the world champions. They've returned as conquerors, and they've returned with nothing but good memories of 83. The spring is a time to bask in the glory of that championship. A World Series victory is the ultimate thrill for any baseball player, and for the Orioles, a blend of veterans and youngsters, it was no different when the corks popped last October.
I waited 9 years for this. All right.
I waited 13.
Just, you know, being a big part of winning, it means it all. This is the biggest win ever.
We're going home the champs, and that's all that counts. We don't care what we do as long as the team wins.
When I put the ring on my finger, I can go out there every day and look and say I was on a world championship club. I'm sure I will realize it.
This will come and go. 2 weeks from now, we'll have bills to pay and start working back in shape again. And this stuff comes and goes, but your family and the Lord and things like that will be with you forever, and they're the most important.
Do you think it was fair that the pitchers kept throwing the balls at Dempsey's bat?
I think it was fair.
I don't know. I must have changed roles somewhere. Somebody mistaked me for somebody else for once. But I don't know. I'm glad that I was able to contribute. It just seemed like, I don't know, the batter's box was a little different. Something was a little bit different because I never expected I'd get the biggest hits, you know, or end up being the MVP of this ball club. We got so many guys that are deserving of that award, and I was just happy that I was chosen.
We got to play some pepper.
But this is 1984, a new year, a new challenge. And manager Joe Altobelli has called his players together and told them they have to forget 1983.
Ironically, you know, for as much as it is difficult to forget 83, that's what we must do when we go into 84. A part of my talk to the ball club prior to the first day of work here in spring training was that we had to do that. If not, let's still try to remember 82 when we lost on the final day. So if we can, if we have to think about 83, throw 82 in there as well, and maybe that'd be the balance we need to get us going in this spring training, because that's what we have to do. I kind of laughed at Jimmy Dwyer, you know, after the meeting I had. He simply said, all my life as a player, I wanted to win, and now I've got to forget about it. But anyway, he said it comically, and it was funny. But nonetheless, for us to compete in 84, we have to go about our business and just think about 1984 and get ready for a championship season again.
When the players arrived at spring training, their thoughts couldn't be hidden. 83 was still on their minds, as were thoughts of repeating that feat in 84.
Oh, I think everybody's elated. So far this spring, everybody's really excited about receiving that World Series ring, and I can't wait to get it myself. And I think it's what it was all about. You know, until we get that ring, I think everybody's just going to be super excited about the World Series still. You know, we're still the champions, and spring training isn't officially started yet, so we're just all waiting for our chance to get those rings on our finger, and then we'll all have to start it all over again to try to win another one.
I thought about, you know, when I left, was I going to be back? I took everything home with me, and I really was, you know, it was a big question mark if I was coming back. But I, you know, over the 2 years I've been here, I tell you, I've really learned a hell of a lot about winning, like, as far as being with the guys here and, you know, the way we played last year. And I think I got that feeling now, and I don't want to leave it.
Now you have the hardest job in the world. Team that's a champion and trying to repeat, and everybody guns for you, and that's gangbusters.
Yeah, we don't look at it like repeating, though. We're looking at it, this as a new season, like we just lost last year. We don't, the only thing we're going to have to show for it is a nice ring on opening day and a big crowd that is going to follow us, I think, the whole rest of the year. And with the team we got now, we're going to be pretty tough. I know one thing for sure, the fans will be able to order their playoff and World Series tickets this year again, as usual.
And many of the experts and the Baltimore fans are expecting the same thing. And that is just going to make the task that much harder. Tonight, we will profile those who must shoulder that burden as we examine the makeup of the Orioles of 84 as they prepare to chase that elusive world championship all over again.
Marshall going to the track, at the wall, gone in the parking lot. So Fernando has given up two doubles and a home run, and it is 5-0 Baltimore.
Plenty of magic on and off the field when the Orioles return home to Baltimore for opening day 84. And Channel 2 Sports will be there to bring the magic to you as the O's battle the AL West champion Chicago White Sox. Coverage begins 12 noon Monday, only on Channel 2.
Welcome back. In this next segment, we'll take a look at the Oriole infield position by position, where the Orioles are led by perhaps two of the biggest superstars in all of the major leagues. Sparky Anderson, the Tigers manager, said last year that having two guys like Cal Ripken Jr. and Eddie Murray in the same infield was unfair. No way those two guys should be on the same team, cried Sparky. But they are, and they both appear to be quite content to remain in Baltimore and combine their efforts for one team. Together last year, they combined for 60 home runs and 213 RBIs, and were among the tops in their positions as fielders. They were both American League All-Stars, and they finished 1-2 in the voting for the American League Most Valuable Player. No wonder opponents feel it's unfair they both wear the same uniform.
Long run for Whitfield. Fair or foul? Fair ball. That's going to mean another run for Baltimore. Ripken's on his way to third as Shelby coasts home, and is 6-1 Baltimore.
For Cal Ripken Jr., it's been almost like a Hollywood scriptwriter dreamed up his story. Raised in the shadows of Baltimore in Aberdeen, raised in an Oriole baseball family, and then grows up to become the team's shortstop, Rookie of the Year, the American League Most Valuable Player Award, and World Series victory, all in just 2 years.
He survived all the questions about the sophomore jinx, and entering his third big league season, the questions are there again. What more can you do?
That's the most common question I've been asked this winter at all these banquets and functions is, well, you won Rookie of the Year first year, you won MVP your second year, what can you do your third year? I don't know. That's a tough question. The only thing that I can do is just try to improve on I guess, every part of your game. I don't have one particular aspect I want to come down here and work on. I would just like to strive out and improve an all-around game. Maybe I won't hit 318, maybe I won't drive in 100 runs, but I think if at the end of the year I can say that I'm improved or that I'm a better ball player, then I have to be satisfied. So I'm just going to take it one game at a time and do the best I can.
He's handled it all so well. The questions, the fans, the press, the pressure, and seems to really be enjoying his rise to the top of the baseball world.
Well, it was very satisfying to win the World Series, and you have all winter to talk to people, and they know you're world champions, and they like talking about the World Series, and you like talking about it. You're number one for that particular year. But then again, as the winter wears on, spring training becomes closer and closer, and you start thinking about the up-and-coming year. I know we're excited about it, but it's tough, though, because you have to leave it in the past now, and you have to go on. That's what's so great about baseball. All the teams are dead even again in spring training. So we have to work just as hard as we did last year, probably a little bit harder because we're going to have a lot of teams shooting at us. We'd like to repeat. We'd like to get back to that World Series and do it again. So we know what it feels like now, and we're going to work a little bit harder to get back.
Cal Sr. has this knack of referring to all his players as his sons, and he's slow to show emotion about Cal Jr.'s accomplishments. But when he does talk about it, the father's pride does shine through.
Well, we were very happy about that. Of course, you're happy because Cal Jr. had a fine year. And as you say, we got a lot of recognition because of what he did. We're very pleased and very proud of his accomplishments. And I'm very pleased and very proud of the accomplishments of all of our children. And certainly my wife should not be eliminated from that either, because I know that she's done a fine job. And I'm very, very happy to have the type of family that I have.
Eddie Murray is the other half of the Oriole duo that terrorizes the other American League teams. Rightly so. 33 home runs, 111 RBIs last year, and a gold glove for the second straight year at first base. Unlike the younger Ripken, Murray is not at ease around reporters and does not enjoy giving interviews. But a check with insiders will reveal that Eddie is quick-witted, with a good sense of humor, and enjoys the companionship of his teammates. He leads by example on the field, and when he does talk, he's modest and quick to point out that there's a lot more to this team than Cal and Eddie.
Well, yeah, it takes more than me. It takes more than Cal. It takes a team effort to win when you go that far. And we just proved that, you know, because there were times during the series where I think me and Cal weren't hitting the ball, and we were still winning ball games. And that was just to prove that point right there.
Eddie Murray, it seems, does not need words for the press. His bat gives plenty to talk about. There was no question about first and short at the start of camp, but with the addition of Todd Cruz in mid-season and Wayne Gross in the off-season, the rest of the infield became crowded, and spring became a time of competition. At third base, the new kid was Wayne Gross, no kid at all at 31 years old and a 7-year veteran, who found himself in camp playing third, a little bit of first base, and even some catching. And coming over from Oakland, he was indeed glad to be with the world champions.
The organization and the team, the players on the team, are just outstanding. They run a first-class organization. It was a little tough to move because I've spent my entire career with Oakland. I've been in the major leagues there for 8 years and set up a home with my family. And to move clear across the country is, you know, going to be an adjustment. But as far as the baseball career goes, I think it's the best thing that could ever happen to me.
Gross was brought in with hopes for a better bat at third base, since Ty Cruz, slick with the glove, had hit only 199 in 83. But Cruz wasn't about to give up, and after spending the winter changing his stance in the instructional league, he came to camp with a change in results.
Hitting is hard. It's not as easy as people, you know, people might think that you're a ball player, you're automatically supposed to hit now. You know, it takes a little bit of work. For me, defensively, I don't have too much of a problem. You know, it comes naturally, you're hitting, I got to really work hard at it.
A footnote to the third base situation. Remember last year the talk of the camp was Leo Hernandez. After an erratic performance last season, he was shipped out to Rochester. He showed up late at camp this year and spent spring training in the background. At second base, the mainstay is Rich Dower, steady and reliable, with a little more crunch in his bat than in the past springs. At 31, aging a bit perhaps, but he knows there's too much talent around to get lazy.
That's got a lot of talent on, but you don't go saying that you're not a platoon player if I don't live up to what I'm supposed to be able to do. I'll either be platooned or I'll be platooned out of here. So you gotta play 100% and get and improve every year. And off of last year, what I did offensively, even though we won the World Series, is really disappointing with my baseball statistics, but very happy with my personal gains. So I'm really looking forward to a good year this year.
Behind Dower is another steady performer, Len Cicada. Cicada was awesome at the plate this spring, coming through time and time again with clutch hits, but he's still resigned to being a backup.
I think all ball players who aren't playing, you know, wish they could play more or expect to play more. That's only natural, but I think on this club, people are, I'm not going to say satisfied, but they know what they have to do in order to help the club, and they're not going to make waves. I think that's the reason why we were successful the last couple of years.
Behind Cicada is the youngster that insiders say will be the heir apparent to Dower and Cicada, 21-year-old Victor Rodriguez. A bright young second baseman who's been playing professionally for 7 years, and he's hit .290 or better for 6 of those years. He'll spend this year in Rochester as he awaits his turn. Talent and depth, what could be better? Perhaps the pitching staff or the outfield. We'll look at that cast of characters when we return. The magic continues. The Orioles pitching staff is the subject of our next segment. And what a pitching staff it is. They have the perfect combination of finesse and experience combined with aggressiveness and youth. And they're led by the man they call Rabbit, Ray Miller.
Hey,
Bobby gets out there and he goes,
what?
He is the guru. They are his followers. Pitching coach Ray Miller, relaxed and easygoing. He guides baseball's strongest pitching staff. Going into this camp, he had 6 potential starters, 3 veterans in the bullpen, and below that, a hungry group of youngsters trying for a spot that might not even be there if his front 9 stay healthy. Maybe that's why Ray Miller smiles so much. A talent-rich pitching corps and a AAA staff with more guys on the waiting list than a Fifth Avenue restaurant.
Joe set everybody down the first day, all the pitchers that are here in camp, and I like the way he thinks, and that's what we did last year, and it proved right. When we go north, even though we only take 9 bodies with us, we figure about a 14-man pitching staff. And by that, I mean Joe will pick out the other 5 key guys that we want. And working closely with Frank Verde at Rochester, we'll make sure that they're working in the schedule of the people that we think they might have to replace if a guy is not going too well, or if he has, one of our pitchers during the year has a muscle strain. It looks like it might go down, or we don't know. Well, we call right away and make sure that the guy we want to replace him is scheduled to work on the same day. And we said that last year, and I don't think the kids really believed us. But lo and behold, we had all those injuries, and the kids come up, and they all did the job, and we won a World Series. So there's a lot more attentiveness now by the younger players. They're okay. I'll be glad to be one of those guys.
A closer look now at those in camp this year. There were 3 with question marks after their names in 1984. The most pressing question, has Dennis Martinez recovered enough from his bout with alcoholism to return to his 1982 form? It was clear he had already won the major battle when he arrived at camp and confronted the press about his problem head on.
It was my drinking, my alcoholism, and now I'm really proud that I'm alcoholic, that I can't drink anymore. And the main thing was this, I admitted that I have a problem. That was one of my trouble that I have last year, that I didn't admit that I have a problem. You know, I never accept the fact that I was something wrong with me. And I just, like I said, I was blaming Joe, I was blaming Dempsey and everybody else. I never blamed myself.
The other question marks center around injuries. Will Mike Flanagan, who began the 83 season 6-0, bounce back strong after the knee injury that kept him out for too much of last season? And will 38-year-old Jim Palmer leave his aches and pains in the locker room and bounce back to help the Orioles this season?
I don't care if you're Eddie Murray or Jim Palmer or Mike Flanagan or Mike Boddicker. Every year is a year where you have to go out and prove yourself. I know, we'll be sitting on the plane and Mike Flanagan sits next to me all the time and he'll say, I just still amazed that you've been able to pitch for 20 years and win 20 games for 8 years, because he says, I know how difficult it is. And I don't think that if I had come down to any of these spring training camps and not have had the incentives or the motivation, I would have been able to do that. And I don't care if you won 260 games or if you won 20, you have to come down here and you have to get your not only physically shape, but you have to get in mental shape and you have to want to go out there and do it. And I think after last year, of course, with the rest of the ball club having so much success, I think there has to be some organizational bewilderment or maybe thinking about whether we really need Jim Palmer or not. And I'm very happy that Hank Peters and Edward Benning-William felt that they wanted me back here. And you know, I had some difficult moments with the fans last year, and I mean, over the course of a year, I suppose you're going to have that. But I have something to prove, not only to myself, but I think to the fans and also my teammates, that I can still go out there and I can still pitch.
There is no question mark when it comes to Scott McGregor. The 30-year-old left-hander led the 83 team in starts, innings pitched, and complete games, compiling an 18-7 record and the lowest ERA of his career, 3.18. He arrived at camp fit and steady as ever, and ready to pitch right from the first day.
You know, one thing I've learned as being a pitcher is once you start taking the mound, it doesn't matter what time of the year it is, your season has started. You know, and when I come down here and start spring training, I figure the season started. When I go out on the mound, I just go out there and pitch, you know, whatever I have that day. During the season, you're never guaranteed to be right and have everything together. You go through ups and downs. So just so far, I've just been able to go out there and execute. And as long as I stay healthy, then it just the strength keeps getting stronger. My arm feels like it's getting stronger each time out. And I know that after a couple more starts, I'll be ready to go up north and be ready to go compete for 7 or 8 strong innings.
Storm Davis didn't listen when someone told him a youngster couldn't make the pitching staff in Baltimore, much less be a starter. But at 22, the youngest player in the American League last year, Storm made his first full year in the majors a success. A 13-7 record and a club-leading 125 strikeouts. It is not etched in stone that Storm will always be a starter. He is polite, though, but firm in expressing the desire to be handed the ball in the first inning as a starter.
I think I'd much rather prefer to be a starter, but I think they're going to wait until about the middle of spring training and then make a decision whether I'll go back to the bullpen and come out for the first 4 weeks or not. And it really doesn't matter to me. You know, our job is to win, and if it calls for me to be in the bullpen for the first 4 weeks and then come out or to start as a starter, you know, come out as a starter, then fine. But either way, whatever it takes to win ball games and to get us back there.
The big surprise last year, a 26-year-old rookie named Mike Boddicker, who toiled for 6 years in the minors before coming up in May, wound up with 16 wins, 5 shutouts, and a 2.77 ERA. Success did little to change the quiet young man from Iowa, but he enjoys having a secure position.
Well, it makes it a little easier. I don't have to impress as many people down here. I don't have to, you know, really have a super fabulous spring to make the team. But then again, it's got to be the same thing. You got to go out there, you got to get in shape, you got to get your throwing in, and still a lot of sweat and hard work involved.
The bullpen will be led by veteran left-hander Tippi Martinez, who enjoyed the best season of his 8-year career in 83, 9 wins, 21 saves. Unlike some relievers, he is not big, nor does he give the appearance of power on the mound. But his curveball is as mean as they come.
Well, I've always had the curveball as a matter of getting the opportunity to throw it more often, and it just so happened that I got the opportunity and things just started working my way.
Also back is Sammy Stewart. The big right-hander from North Carolina came on strong in the second half of 83 and did not allow a run in 9 1/3 innings of the postseason. Once again, Stewart is expected to be used in a variety of situations, and that suits him just fine because he feels he's a part of a team that just might have the makings of a dynasty.
Well, I think we're capable of having a dynasty here. I think with Ripken and Murray, and we've helped ourselves tremendously with Wayne Gross and Tom Underwood, and I think we're a lot stronger. But the thing we have to do is get off to a good April and May and make sure that, you know, we come on strong like we always do. But the most important thing now is to get started healthy, and we haven't had any injuries, knock on wood, and just, you know, start the season off on the right track.
A new addition this year is Tom Underwood, signed as a free agent out of Oakland. The left-hander is expected to give Tippi some help with short relief, and he's also capable of long work and occasional starting. Bubbling beneath the regulars are several young pitchers who have big league material already and have proven it during the 83 season. Guys like Bill Swaggerty, Alan Ramirez, and Dan Morajello.
I walk around a spring training on pins and needles just hoping everybody stays healthy, but so far I'm pleased, and I'm really looking forward to a year. Just one time I'd like to have this pitching staff healthy all year and see what it can do.
That might be very interesting indeed, except maybe to the young guys on the waiting list in Rochester and opposing players who have to face the guys who take the mound for Baltimore.
Back once again. In this next segment, we're going to take a look at the man who epitomizes the Baltimore Orioles, a guy who probably sleeps in his uniform. We couldn't be talking about anybody else but the Dipper, Rick Dempsey.
Rick Dempsey reminds you of the guy you grew up with, who you always wanted on your side. Words usually picked to describe him are along the lines of scrappy, dogged, aggressive, and intense. The one nickname he has never carried is Slugger. A lifetime 240 hitter, he surprised all by exploding in last year's World Series.
Baltimore leading it. And Dempsey, who hit a home run his first time up, may have another one. That drive is off the wall and bouncing back to Matthews, and he settles.
The Dipper stunned the Phillies by hitting 385 with a record 5 extra base hits for a 5-game series, and capped off the series in Game 5 with an awesome display of power.
I'll tell you something, he is having a great series, proving what a great clutch player he is.
After that came the real thrills, the hit of the postseason parade. Then a busy but relaxing offseason in which to soak up the benefits of being the MVP.
John, here's the next season. Hope we have another big winner.
And another MVP.
Right? Oh, I love it. I love it.
Now it slides into the past. Memories for the scrapbook. And Rick Dempsey must move forward to 1984 and a new challenge.
Now it's time to get on with winning another one and the challenge of this year. How is it heading in right now?
Well, I look at things very good so far this spring. Everybody has come to spring training not with a new era of cockiness or anything, but definitely determined to repeat what we did last year. And that's a good feeling. Our pitching staff is in extremely good shape right now, I feel. They've been throwing the ball very well for this early in the spring. They know that we have to get off to a good start like we did last year, because there's so many teams in our division now to contend with. There's four teams that could beat us. If we don't get off to a good start, you know, any one of them can keep us from winning it. So I'm very happy with spring training, the way things have gone. For myself personally, I haven't hit the ball very well, but, you know, this is one spring out of about the last four or five that I haven't hit the ball well and started the season terribly. Yeah. Now that I had a bad spring, maybe I'll start the season good.
I think if I won a World Series personally, I'd want to retire. I'd say, forget it, that's it, how would I top that? But, you know, you guys got to go back out there again in a little while and do it all over again. How do you get yourself mentally motivated? What's your own personal philosophy for going out there for another season?
Well, you look back at the seasons that you've had and the successes that you had in the past. And we had a fantastic time last year. We played a lot of those kind of games that everybody refers to as Oriole magic. And you just want to continue to have that on and on. The feelings don't last long enough as far as I'm concerned. You know, just for a couple of months during the baseball season isn't enough. After everybody's had a layoff and they get a full season of football and basketball, they want to see some good baseball again, come out to the ballpark, take their shirts off, get tan, have a few beers, and see some Oriole magic. And I want to give it to them. You know, I think all of the guys on this club, we want to get those feelings again. It's a feeling of camaraderie. We all have a good time. And for 6 and 7 months of that kind of ball play, I mean, you know, you just want to do it for the rest of your life. That's motivation enough in itself.
The last memory you have of playing baseball when it counted, you were hitting the ball pretty well and setting some records and winning most, but you think you're going to have to carry this team offensively again now?
I don't know. You know, the load got kind of heavy and my back's been a little bit stiff this spring, but it's loosened up a little bit. Eddie's promised he's going to have a little better season this year, and they're going to try to take off some of the pressure in the playoffs. You know, I'm a small guy and I just can't carry these guys for that long. You know, we're a series here or a series there, but the whole season, man, you know, my back can't stand that kind of pressure.
We'll have to talk to them, see if we can get them play a little better. What about the reporting now? You spent this spring with a different type of stick in your hand, one like this. How was that as an experience?
Well, you can tell all the guys down at News Scene 2 that I have no aspirations of becoming a reporter at this time, okay? I want 6 or 7 more years of this game, and then they're in trouble.
Okay, I'm glad that, because I could be in trouble, you know? And believe me, if I had to switch jobs with you, we're both in trouble.
No. We had a good time, John. It was a lot of fun, and that's just as far as it goes. That's it.
Perhaps the biggest adjustment for Rick Dempsey this year was mastering his role as a feature reporter for News Scene 2 during spring training. The first thing Rick learned is that you don't have to get it right on the first try.
Hi, I'm Rick Dempsey, and I'm here at my penthouse at Key Biscayne, Florida,
Nah, let's try it again. Hi, I'm Rick Dempsey, and I'm here at...
But when he did get it right, we were in for some laughs, most valuable player style. The gang went golfing, and Rick turned the fairway into a battle zone.
You're all right, John. I didn't mean to throw it, but that ball's out of bounds.
We went fishing with Rick, and when the fish didn't bite, he did.
I'll show him how to get it.
Rick's parents had a vaudeville background, so it was natural to engage in a little bit of slapstick.
And I am the boss.
Oh, you see that?
Yeah.
And he even brought us some new talent discoveries.
It's a family affair. It's a family affair. It's a family affair.
Baby, I was blind to let you go.
In the midst of all this insanity, he didn't forget his work, working diligently to recapture that most valuable player swing, getting his body ready for all those bumps and bruises to come. Rick will be backed up again by veteran Joe Nolan, but he was never too busy to spend a while with the young catchers in camp on their way up.
I get to that point sometimes where, especially when I'm just throwing guys out, then I'll start getting real relaxed sometimes. You know, just, you know, I get all the time in the world because my arm's feeling strong, and I'll start relying on it, and then I start getting lazy, and then I don't start picking guys off or anything unless I know I got them dead.
Yeah.
And that's when I try to get myself going again, start trying to pick guys
off.
So
you look for plays, you know, you look to set on plays, and you're always watching for the guys that are taking one extra step off the base. Every single base runner, you're always looking at it. But I don't think that even 95% of the time do you ever even try to pick them off.
Rick Dempsey, ball player, actor, and perhaps the heart and soul of the Oriole Ball Club. Rosters of most baseball teams, you're trying to figure out who's going to be the fourth, the fifth, or the sixth outfielder. When you look at the roster of the Orioles, you're trying to figure out who's going to be the eighth, the ninth, or possibly the tenth. And that's the type of depth the Orioles have in the outfield. In this next segment, we'll examine that depth.
It takes a quick eye and a full roster sheet to keep up with the outfielders on this Orioles club. It is one big jigsaw puzzle, and at the beginning of spring training, there were more pieces than places in the puzzle. The mystery is not in left or center. The left field lineup will, for the most part, be that proven tandem of John Lowenstein and Gary Renicke. The two combined for 34 home runs and 124 RBIs playing in the platoon system last year, and you don't argue with stats like those. The center field duo consists of a couple of opposites, the wily veteran, Al Bumbrey, and the young and shy, John Shelby. At 36, Bumbrey is at one end of his career, and Shelby, meanwhile, is at the beginning of his. Shelby's been brought along slowly by the organization, and although he's impatient at times, he realizes it's been for the best.
Speaking for myself, I feel that I don't know, I figured I could probably been playing a long time ago, but the way I look at it now, the way that they play me, I feel deep down in my heart that they brought me along at the right time, and I think a lot of these other guys probably feel the same way.
For Al Bumbrey, it was not enough to finish up with a World Series victory. In 84, he wants another chance to bring that trophy home to Baltimore.
Well, I think the big thing, you know, ever since I've been here with the Orioles, you know, when September rolls around, you know, we're either in first place or close to first place, you know, with a chance of getting into the playoffs, and I don't see any reason why that should change. Again, you know, it's one thing about this ball club we have and the ball clubs that we leave spring training with, you know, for some reason, we always seem, you know, to put things together, and I would anticipate, you know, when September rolls around, you know, we'll be right near first place, in first place, and we stand just as good a chance as, you know, as anyone else as far as getting to the playoff again. But, you know, it would be a total surprise to me, you know, if when September rolls around, the Orioles were not there.
The remaining outfield spots required a juggling act in spring training, a look at the cast of characters. Proven veteran Dan Ford, despite nagging injuries, was the front runner among the pack. In 83, he hit 280 with 9 home runs, including a couple of game winners. A free agent in the offseason, he admits he thought about leaving this crowded situation.
I tell you, it feels good to come back as a winner. Over the winter, I sit at home, and everybody was asking me how it feel to be a world champion. I said, really, it really hasn't hit me yet. I haven't got my ring or my trophy, and, you know, leaving Baltimore like that and coming home, and people was calling me, congratulating, and I tell you, it's a good feeling.
Perhaps the crowd favorite this spring for that job was Tito Landrum, the 29-year-old reserve who came to Baltimore late last season and immediately fit in with his new teammates. And then he made himself known to all the baseball world in Game 4 of the American League Championship Series when he broke up that nothing-nothing tie in the 10th inning with this home run.
Wait a minute.
Oh, my goodness.
Hold on to this one.
I believe
one. Get out of here, ball.
Deck.
Home run, Tito Landrum.
Oh, and he didn't. Did he miss it?
It just cut a hole in the wind, and Landrum has scored the first run in the ball game here in the 10th inning. And you think that dugout won't greet him? Watch this.
Yes, sir. Give him a high five, Eddie Murray.
Once again this spring, he fit right into the Orioles' picture. His contribution on the field was outstanding, playing excellent defense and hitting over the 400 mark. And away from the field, his personality made him one of the favorites among teammates and media alike.
I need a practice swing. I was straight as an arrow. Now watch.
But it's a numbers game in baseball, and on the last Sunday morning of camp, Tito Landrum sat at his locker and talked about his future. He had just been traded back to the St. Louis Cardinals.
Somebody told me not long ago that they did not want to trade me, in fact, and they wanted to keep me. But, of course, I was frozen at the time when I was sent down, and it was very difficult for them to bring me back up. So it just so happens that it's very funny to me for the simple fact that they have some talented outfielders over there, too, and I'm just wondering how really I'm going to fit in, but I understand that I'll probably be much like defensive replacements for somebody, pinch hitting and some pinch running.
The Orioles had decided to stick with the veterans who had been with the club for a while. Benny Ayala was strong and consistent this spring at the plate, and Jim Dwyer, coming off one of his best years in the big leagues, showed no signs of fading. And that leaves rookie Mike Young, a name most Oriole fans are familiar with already. He was in camp a year ago, and everybody was calling him the next Eddie Murray. He spent nearly 2 months with the big club last summer. This year, he came to camp knowing that once again, he might be the odd man out, forced to go back to Rochester to wait.
Well, basically, it's the same as it was last year. I came into spring training last year with the assumption that I was going to make the team, although it didn't work out that well. This year, I might be a little bit more relaxed than I was last year because of the fact that although I went down to winter ball and I did exceptionally well, I think in 1984, this year, this could be possible the year of Mike Young, hopefully, and I'm hoping that. And if it doesn't really work out that way, then all I can say is that, you know, just to keep trying, because at this point in my life, I don't think I can turn back and give up. If it was given to me the type of role that T-Bone was given last year for me to play up here in the major leagues, I think that's the goal of every guy that's in professional baseball, making the team, regardless of what type of role that you may play, although I'd like to play every day. But if they prefer me to be up there and play the same way in a platooning system, platooning basis, just like T-Bone played last year, then I would be all for that, because I don't think they're going to do anything that's going to be detrimental to me and to my health. So, you know, I'll be all for it.
Insiders say he's pressing a bit now and may need the time in Rochester, but sooner or later he must be brought up to stay. Joe Altobelli thought about it a lot as the weeks went by in camp.
I know I asked myself the question, in Mike Young's case especially, that if I can get him the amount of playing time that would keep him sharp at the major league level, that's one thing. Mm-hmm. If the answer comes up that we can't get him as much playing time as we'd like to, then he's better off going down, getting involved, playing a lot, and if something were to happen, to be ready for us when that time came. If he spent a month with our ball club and didn't play much, and then the opportunity came, he might not be quite ready for it.
A year ago, there was doubt in the mind of Ken Singleton that he would be around at the end of spring training, but he followed a good spring with a good season, hitting .276 with 18 home runs from the DH spot. This year, there was no worried look on his face. The smile is back, and the confidence level is much higher.
Well, even more so than last year, I knew I was one of the question marks. And one of the things that people worried about my right-handed hitting, when I came to spring training last year and I started hitting, I knew right away I was going to have a better year, and I was looking forward to it. This year, my confidence is up even more so. Of course, we're the world champions, and that gives us something else to shoot for again this year. And I'm hoping to make contributions toward that end again.
I think we saw in 82 that a lot of times pitchers were coming after you when they hadn't in the past. And maybe towards the beginning of last year they were doing it too, not sure that you could come back. How do you expect pitchers to change as they face you this year?
Well, I think they're going to basically try the same thing. I think as the season wore on last year, they became more wary again. They started pitching around me and walking me. I ended up second in the league in walks. But I think they're going to try and do the same things, maybe mix in a few more breaking balls. Last year, they didn't throw me too many until towards the end of the season when everybody found out he was hitting a fastball again. Don't lay it in there anymore.
And another note on the outfielders, keep an eye on this guy, Larry Sheets. He is 24 years old, and he trained with the big club for the first time this year. He's been in and out of organized baseball a couple of times, but apparently the Orioles saw enough of his hard hitting to give him a good long look for the future. The future is one thing the Orioles organization thinks about quite a bit. And with this crop of outfielders, a rare blend of veterans and youngsters, this year looks bright for the Birds, and so does that future.
The Chicago White Sox, in their first game of the season, turn to Channel 2 for complete opening day coverage. It starts at noon when New Scene 2 broadcasts live from Memorial Stadium. At 12:30, a special edition of Orioles on Deck. John Saunders and Scott Garceau bring you the background, color, and excitement of opening day. Then at 2, the O's meet the White Sox. A full afternoon of Oriole magic, Monday on Channel 2.
Joe Altobelli strolled into camp this year with a bit of a swagger, and indeed he should. He replaced a legend in Earl Weaver, and not only did he uphold the winning tradition, he took the team a step further and won a world championship. A nice thought to chew on during the winter, and upon returning in 84, everyone wanted to know if he felt any different.
Well, it really shouldn't be any different, Jack. Of course it is. We did win everything last year. I feel good about that. I'm sure our players do as well. But I think the big key is that it is spring training. It's a time to prepare for another championship season. So each time I do think about last year, I kind of close the door on it as quickly as I can and get back to what's supposed to be done on this field in order to get our ball club ready.
His predecessor showed up only once this spring to say hello. No longer was he a shadow looming over Altobelli, only a figure removed to the past. This was clearly Joe Altobelli's team now. He has some strong support help from his staff. The lead man in his camp is Cal Ripken Sr., 28 years with the Orioles. Ray Miller, 13 years with the O's. He has four different 20-game winners and two Cy Young recipients. Jimmy Williams, first base coach, 38 years in baseball, the last seven with the Orioles. Elrod Hendricks, the Orioles' ambassador of goodwill and bullpen coach, 15 years in the organization.
I was running that thing like I had a load of moonshine on it.
And Ralph Rowe, the O's hitting instructor, 38 years in baseball, 7 with the Birds. It's his job to fine-tune those bats. These are the guys who keep the wheels turning in camp day after day.
There's no doubt, right? They know exactly what they're doing, and if they don't, we confer after a ball game or before a game. We're here early enough. Our program doesn't start as a rule until 10 in the morning, and our coaches are here somewhere around 8 o'clock, quarter to 8, and gives us a couple of hours to discuss our daily routine.
The man above all those in uniform, General Manager Hank Peters. It's his job to fine-tune the overall machine. And one wonders if he has the urge to tinker.
I've often said, when you have a winning ball club, you never overhaul it. You might have to tinker with it. And I think that's what we've done this winter. We have tinkered a little bit by picking up a couple new players, Tom Underwood and Wayne Gross, some of the younger players that will get a good look here this spring out of the farm system. And I don't think that we need an awful lot. I don't think that any of the parts from last year have worn out, let's put it that way. And we think that all of them can come back and have good years. The ill and the wounded are all healed and healthy, and we think that with the return of the veterans and the new people we have, this is going to be just a super year for us.
And even above him is owner Edward Bennett Williams, who sits high up in his booth and looks down and nods at how well things operate below.
I call them the Band of Brothers. I name them the Band of Brothers. I'm very proud of the fact that we haven't lost anyone from our organization in my years as owner. We've kept the team intact. We've kept the organization intact. And I think that kind of continuity has contributed to whatever success we've had. I think it's a big factor. And so it's very pleasing when I'm able to say, yes, we have the same manager, we're going to keep the same manager. We have the same executive vice president, general manager, we're keeping him. And we have the same ball club. We've tried to improve it in a couple of vital spots, and I think we have improved it. The question is, have we improved it sufficiently in relationship to the other teams in the American League?
To call the Orioles brothers certainly is a true statement. The Pittsburgh Pirates may have called themselves family, but the Orioles truly live it. And when you look at the upcoming 84 season, it's really tough to look at a team and say that they could upend the Orioles in their quest for a second straight world championship. And the fans have certainly caught on as well. We've already sold over 1 million tickets for the upcoming season. The Orioles are certainly well within reach of that 2.5 million goal that they're trying to set for this year. So that's about it for Orioles 84. The magic continues. Don't forget, tomorrow, New Scene 2's coverage of the Orioles starts at noon with the noon news, and will continue right through the ring ceremony and on through the game with Chuck Thompson and Brooks Robinson having the call. That's all from Miami. For everyone who helped us with this special, I'm John Saunders. Thank you very much for watching.
Orioles 84, The Magic Continues, has been brought to you by your Toyota dealers, who ask the question, what will you do with all the money you save?
Some excerpts from NBC News correspondent Ken Bodie's journal on presidential pitching tests.